Now, in response, I would like a pleasing UK round of applause for our first guest, David Wake.
All right.
I should have done it in the British way. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm doing a talk on fictional games. I became kind of interested in it to, obsessive states. And I reached some sort of very interesting conclusions about it. Then I did some more research and realised I was completely wrong. This is also the second PowerPoint I've ever made. First one I've ever made on my own. So I copied a little bit from, shall I change the font? I can't follow. Oh, I can put pictures in this. So fictional games, what do I mean by a fictional game? Can we get this to work? I want to use Quidditch as my example. I kind of wanted to do board games. But I decided on Quidditch as being a game that first existed in a book. And here are the rules. And I think these are the issues. Now, there's two I want to point out to you. Quidditch matches blah, 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 blah. And they score 10 points. Right? So everybody in the team scores 10 points if they manage to get a ball through there. Right? Blah, 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 blah. If you're Harry Potter, you catch the Stitch, and you score 150 points. Now, any gamers in the room will realise the flaw in this game sort of pretty much straight away. Because the correct strategy for the chasers, the beaters, the keeper, is to go to the pub. Wait to see what the result of the game is. So there's an obvious issue with certain fictional games being unplayable. Also, I'm interested in games that make the leap from the fictional world to the real world. And Quidditch is one of those that has managed to become a real game. They have modified the rules slightly. There's no flying or magic. And they've changed, I'm sure they've put magic in, but they've changed the rules for scoring as well, I would believe. So this, I think, illustrates kind of where I was interested in. Games that are fictional, that then make the leap to the real world, and kind of why. Harry Potter has another game. Oh, it's also a board game. You play Quidditch and things like this. I also discovered animation, so quite a lot of this is going to surprise me. there's Wizard's Chess, which you all know, which has, you can play it for real, people play Wizard's Chess for real. A fine example here is Wizard's Chess being played for real. And you realise straight away that this is just chess with special effects. It's nothing special at all. Except, of course, you can buy a set of this and it costs a fortune. I want to talk about chess. There's a concept called fairy chess, where you basically can change the types of pieces that you use. You can change the size of the board, and you can change all the rules. This, I would love to play this. This is fantastic. I think it's called Regiment's Chess. Regiment's Chess. And you have a huge long board. I think it's deeper as well. A huge long board with hundreds of pieces that are the same. So you have a sort of regiment of bishops. And you can move the whole regiment of bishops as a bishop. If you've got queens and rooks together, you can move the whole lot forward. You can only move most of its diagonal. So regiments break up and reform, and then you crash into another regiment on the opposite side, you can do an awful lot of damage. Pieces are taken at a frightening pace. I've seen an animation these days, computer version. It really looked like armies moving across the board, rather than this idea of individual champions of the game. So that's fairy chess. Then there's got sort of variations. This is three-player chess. It's three different types of chess. Four different types of chess. Play with three players. Four-player variants and things. Hexagons. Ridiculous. So people have taken chess and modified it. And that seems to be one of the rules of it. You'll recognize this one, I'm sure. This is 3D chess from Star Trek. They've quickly made a board. And people have done rules for this. This is yet another game that explains the leap into the real world, with real people playing. And obviously you can buy sets for a fortune. But the rules for this were created sometime after they first did it by fans. So if I guess if you analyse what Spock and Kirk are doing, they're not playing 3D chess, they're just really thinking about random, which is fairly appalling. There are other variants of 3D chess. I've kind of talked a lot about chess, so obviously I didn't reorder my slides properly because I should have done this slide a lot earlier to talk about the two different types of fictional games. I found something on the internet that said there are two types of games. Number one is chess, e.g. stealth chess. So it's basically fairy chess, writ large, you get a number of pieces, you move things around. This is stealth chess from Discworld, which is just chess with extra pieces and extra rules. The second form is poker. There are various types of poker you get, basically card-based games. This is Fizbin from Star Trek, which is a game that he's making up as he goes along in the episode. I know if you remember the episode. So this is kind of an episode about how Star Trek's 3D chess was invented. Of the two different fictional types, number three is race games like Stakes and Ladders. This is Jumanji, which is roll dice and move things around. You can see that when I did my research, I then realised that there was another one. And then yesterday, I was having conversations with people. And I realised there was a fourth type, which is, if somebody give me a magic marker, I should just write it down. Which are puzzle games. I completely forgot about the Celestial Toymaker from Doctor Who, where they had a, is it the Towers of Babel? Sorry?
Towers of Benoit.
What do you mean, the pieces of that? So there's
puzzle games. He makes a mistake if I recall that.
Yeah?
That's what I noticed for the age of eight.
I had wanted to illustrate all three, but all four types of game that you see here with Discworld. Terry Pratchett has three sets of games, but unfortunately, he doesn't have a race game. He does have two different types of chess-based games. Yes. Oh yes, go on,
please. So one of the sub-games he collects is a race game.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, this slide will eventually be much better now that I have a bit of a better.
Clacks. The major game is sort of a competitive puzzle game.
It's based on, it's not actually played in Discworld, is it? It's one based on Discworld rather than FUP, which
true.
Is actually played in
Discworld.
You're taking notes now.
I'm going to take notes, yes, that's the only way to do it. No, I'm getting out of prop. So that was Discworld games. Thud here is based on Tafl, which is a Viking game. Which again, it's sort of a chess-like draft type of game. And I think Terry Pratchett just described it in the book, and then somebody went away and made a variant. I think I want to do a demo. Can I have two volunteers, please? Or I'll pick people. David, come here up. John.
take a little bit of time to familiarise yourself with that rule, the rules of the game. Number four is probably the most important. While I set out the starting mission, just cheat. But I'm doing it. Right.
It's a battle check.
I was going to go through and see if people have guessed what these games were. Clearly, everybody's now going to get this game.
you will give the part to an improviser.
Right, John, if you could do a few moves, that would be lovely. And while you're getting that back together, let's do the competition. Who got A? A comes in two parts. Did you get where it comes from? Do you know what it's called?
What's it called?
It's also the first season of the Millennium Falcon.
This is Dejeric. I'm really pleased with the graphic effect. Okay, number two. Have you got number two? I'll reveal it later on. Anybody get C? C. Sorry? Can you name what it's from now?
What is Applejack?
Right. What I wanted to point out is that these two people are doing a fairly convincing fictional game. But this is completely made up. There's no rules to this game at all. Dawn, do you want to read out the rules?
So we could read it sometime. The rules. The rules, the instructions here that we made. The rules are: add an element to a piece. These are elements, so you've got circly ones, square ones, and they come off. You add an element to a piece, add a hexagon to another one to continue the board, or move a piece.
And we can do any two of following in any order, and we've only been doing them.
That's true. We've been playing by the rules, have we?
So that's right. Pointing out, thank you very much for pointing it out, that often when you see a fictional game played on Tony films, like 3D chess in Star Trek, they're not doing it right.
Yes, that was deliberate.
And as number four,
don't overact!
So no one would have got this game because I was trying to invent a game that became far too complicated, so I've just brought the pieces along. There's no rules for it. It's so fictional. It doesn't even have a name. Well, it does have a name.
So what's it from, dude?
It's not from anything.
Okay.
It is.
But I'm trying to point out how easy it is to make something look convincing. I mean, I wonder if, having watched those two, if I hadn't given away that they're really playing Mornington Crescent, whether I could give the piece to two other people and they could work out what the rules are. I mean, that would be kind of interesting, I think. Shall I go through the rest of these, or shall I leave it as a surprise for later, because they do come up later? I'll bat one. Okay, this is Dejeric, which is from Star Wars. It's been in the original series, the new ones, and that's from Rogue One. Which is kind of like with the chess, isn't it? You see the monsters going killing each other. It's kind of CGI. It's
like it's the chess men of Mars from Edgar's Brothers, but with a smaller.
Yeah. But it just looks good, doesn't it? It is one that's made a vaguish leap into the real world. In the sense that this is the only game you can buy, which is a small kind of miniature model of it that goes in your big model Millennium Falcon. And I cannot believe no one has gone for the marketing opportunities for producing a game. Just staggering that it just doesn't exist. Well, how's it? It's 1977, so it's been a while. Should be
probably got
to
afford the licensing now.
I was going to say, is there copyright and licensing?
There will be, but the people who own the copyright and licensing like to make money out of fans, don't they? It's just a monopoly set-sized box, isn't it? With a fold-out board that's round. There's some pieces. rules. People have done rules. I saw one person explaining a set of rules using chess pieces, but he had assigned different movements to the chess pieces than the traditional chess pieces. So let's use a bishop, he was saying, they can move orthogonally. And let's use a queen, she can move diagonally, but only by two squares. I think, why didn't we use chess pieces? This, if I could have got this bit to work, this would be impressive. A bloke has done an augmented reality version. So you plonk pieces of tiles down on the board, and you look through goggles and see the figures in holograms. So this is the holographic version to make them leap to the real world, which I think is just brilliant. So that's Djarik, which is one of the traditional chess games. I'm going through the chess variant stuff. Here's Saivasi, Game of Thrones, where they play a chess variant, of which there are two different types, sort of one on a hexagon board and one on this board. The interesting thing about this game is there's a barrier in between, so you take your pieces out, there's a hidden movement element. Again, it's chess, isn't it? So that's the ultimate one, and that's chess done. Moving on to the second of our
types of games, there's sort of card-based games. Battlestar Galactica has pyramids. In the original series, pyramids look like playing cards. And in the new series, it was running about with a ball playing with hoops.
It's actually in the original, and they were dressed in rather
leather jock straps.
Yes. You mean like that?
That's it.
They had another game called Triad. The original game, this is one about the ball
wearing
very little. And in the new reimagined one, it was playing cards because the writers got them the wrong way around. but it's just poker playing poker
with cards that own clay. You get the goldfish shuffle.
This is why Starbuck likes it.
Yeah. They had a horrified.
You could actually buy pyramids. It was commercially released.
Did it have rules different from poker?
Yeah, I don't know. I know somebody who did buy it. I don't know how easy it was to play or anything like that. You could buy the game. Somebody made it.
And there are more than likely people dressed in very little clothes. They had a hatred of corners, didn't they?
For some reason.
So that's your poker-based games. I've not got much to say about them. I'm not really a poker player. The best one for it is this one. The rules of Knifey Spoonie are you have to carry your own set around of Knifey Spoonie. You compare knives with each other, and whoever's got the biggest knife wins. Unless a player plays a spoon, which always beats a knife. Unless the other person points out that it is a spoon. Those are the rules written down there. So this is where that phrase comes in. If you show somebody a spoon and they go, that's a spoon. The answer is you go, oh, you've played knife and spoon before. Or not. But it's poker, isn't it? You know, I'll see your knife. So, now to move on to the third of the two different categories, which are race games. I think the most famous Jumanjian Bathura. This film's based on board games, so it's not just the thing in the background like Jarek was. It is what the film's about. They start to play Jumanji for real. They start playing Bathura for real.
Tron is cyber game.
That's of the two different types
of games within games and sports.
Mm-hmm. Of the two different types of games, number six are sports games.
The service just gets longer.
Because there's pyramids or trial or whatever it was. There's rollerball.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's not a board game.
That's not a board game. So we'll discount it. I'll discount Tron as well.
Yeah.
It's a computer game, not a car.
You can include the holodeck scrolls on the Enterprise and DS9.
Can you?
So you do games in them as well.
Yes, but isn't that simply a better, easier way of doing, you know, if you wanted to play rugby, putting a rugby pitch in a spaceship would be different. On a holodeck, it would be quite easy. So they play real games. It's just the mechanism to do real. It's like saying, is it real turf or asterisk turf?
Yeah.
Or a holographic turf. I've got out of that hole.
Yeah. 7 out of 10 for the remaining judge.
Another set of race games on Monopoly. I just put that in because I'm going to have a look.
Oh, lovely.
That's a version of Monopoly that are playing on Blake 7 with less squares. It doesn't really work, I don't think, as a fictional game. I can't quite believe. And this is Moonopoly, which was from
Moon 02.
Which someone pointed out to me. I really love about this. There's the little houses and things in the craters. That looks very natural. It's a very nice play, isn't it? Where am I?
29th.
It's early yet, you should be able to still remember.
Yeah. So, what do I think are the best games that I've come across that really work well? Well, I wanted to do B. Did everybody guess what B was? B's a real one. This is Quintet, which is
all new. I've not seen it.
I remember this from the very first convention I went to, which was Novacon, and people trying to say me to go to the convention. I thought, what do you do at convention? But they showed films, and I was into films. I did the maths, you pay to join the convention, and I got to see 5 films, and that was the work that's like him. And Quintet was on the sea, it was late at night, started I think at midnight. And it's set in a post-apocalyptic world where there's an ice edge going on. And the game, the film was so successful, I started to feel really cold. What I didn't realise was the hotel had switched the heating off. So I was frozen by the end of it. This is, the board game is central to the film. They're playing this board game here. I think it is very playable. Except for one really weird element. Oh, and then, of course, they start to play the board game for real. It's a sort of assassination game. You roll dice and you move different ways around the board. And if you land on the opponent, you move a piece. Most of the most important pieces are out. And you can put pieces into a safety zone in the middle. It's played with 6 players. 5 players are cocaine. And then the 6th player has to go around and give bad advice to the other players to try and ensure that the worst player wins. So, because I think whittles it down, we end up with 1 player. And then the winner of the 5 player game plays against the 6th player, and it's the first one to roll a 5 wins. Forgive me for pointing something out, but you don't need to ensure that the worst player ends up, because I don't think a worst player.
Maybe the least, but you can give them a d4.
First one to roll a 5, and your choice of dice. But I do want to play Quintet if somebody wants to have a game at some point, or wants to try these things out. That would be grand. But I think, a fictional game that's genuinely works, and I think that the makers of the film played a few games of it to make sure it did work, with this slight proviso of lunacy. The other one I would like to point out is, well, does anybody, somebody did get this one. I think this one is D. I know someone knows it. Go on.
It's called Tack.
And it's from?
The Patrick Ross was Little Wing Universe.
It's a fantasy series, isn't it?
Yeah.
And that's it, Tack. It just means words. That is what it says in The Wise Man's Fear.
Tack number one.
And it's just, they played a game, someone beat them. Simply. Mm-hmm. That's it, as far as I can make out.
Yeah.
The only description of this game. And then a bloke came along and said, I'd like to make it. So the two sort of worked together. I think Patrick Loftus is only there because he wrote in the book. The only work is James Ernest.
James Ernest made him play it.
Yes, he did. Well, yes, it is. There he is. Forcing him to play. This is an absolutely fascinating game because you've got to make a road across the board from one side to the other board, top to bottom. And in the books, there's a thing called the long road in the world. So it's based on the world in a sort of abstract sense. And it's a little bit like Noughts and Crosses in that you put pieces down early on trying to get a line, and then as you stack them up you get to move them around like chess. So it evolves from a Noughts and Crosses game to a chess game. And we've had a couple of games, but only enough to realise that this has got a deep game.
It's deceptively simple.
It is. To explain the rules makes no time at all. And then you suddenly go, I'm playing chess at grandmaster level here. And it has made the jump to the real world. Obviously, it's the bloke who invented the game, but they have world championships of it. The rules for the people. And one of the things tax players do is that they make their own games. So obviously I started to make my own pieces and so forth. But board. Has this lovely feature that you can play on the squares or you can play on the intersections. So you can have different sized boards on the same board. And it's really, once you get it very obvious, you can play a 3x3, 4, 5, 6. It's very clever. It's simple, it's elegant. So this would be my winner. It's the best game in a fictional world that's made that leap to the real world. That's actually playable. So I'm going to end with what makes a good fictional game. And I think, number one, it should be playable. And that's it. did anybody guess E? Circle that. Go on.
Like a film of Dan
I don't know what it's called, but I have played it. I mean, probably the only person in this room, apart from you and Dawn, has played it.
And well, you know, gets away where it comes from.
this is a game without a name yet, because I want to put a game in a fictional world that I'm writing, and I want it to be playable. So I wouldn't mind having a few games and watching other people play this game, just to make sure I can get something that works. It's based on Makala, which is an African game. It's if you take all the variants into account, it's made Colour is the most popular game on the planet. Which is a surprise. That's it. Any questions?
Good news. You've managed to leave yourself a full 10 minutes.
Oh, 10 minutes of questions. That's good.
Maybe a little bit more as well.
Go.
I've got a friend who's a games designer. I think you met him, Andy.
I have, yes.
Who says, you say it must be playable.
Yeah.
He says, if it makes you swear, laugh, or shout, it's a good game.
Okay, so there's
the
difference between
playable
and
yes.
Depends if that's
when
you're
reading
the book. So computer games are the best games, because you're always swearing.
Yes.
But not necessarily for the right reasons.
So if it gets an emotional reaction.
Yeah, I think for his games, if it gets an emotional reaction, he thinks it's a good game. Yeah, it's engagement. It can be, and actually many of Andy Hopwood's games, you do all three at some point.
You know, actually, what's the game that sort of knocks across his
top? Oh, Mind Leaf.
Mind Leaf. Because he just invented that, didn't he?
Yeah. It always looks like, I take it to reenactment events, because it looks really, really medieval, but it's not. It's about 7, 8 years old now.
I wonder if I could save myself a lot of time. Ask him if I can put it into a fictional world.
Well, it's not as if you don't live in the same city.
No.
Yeah, well, you could steal my leaf.
Yeah. It's got a nice name as well, hasn't it?
So a fictional game before a fictional book.
Yeah.
Yeah, great.
It's a real game.
I might sell some more copies for him as well, together.
Yeah.
Maybe you wouldn't have copyright.
I don't think I can get copyright of the car.
No, but you could have your edition.
Yeah, my edition.
Doesn't stop Apple trying to claim anything.
Yeah, that's true.
It's a question from the front side.
Yes.
Are there any games like Patriot Stretch Solitaire that you play on your own, or are they all two or more players?
What's a fictional game with self-discovery stories that death set patients? Assumably, if you did actually manage to win the game, you died shortly thereafter.
But yes, but not good.
Ah.
And is there a real world equivalent of that? You buy a set and then you die later on.
I think there was
Dr. Bobby.
I've read a book, or something in the audience, or you can remind me of the title. It's by Catherine Asaro, and I think that was Hawking. It was a science fiction book, but there's people that are playing a complicated game like Tac. but with many, many more pieces and things like what the pieces are made of is important. And if you get really good at this, you can kind of, the game predicts the future, mostly economics and politics. But so as well as the people playing the game, part of the book is people trading players to other nations and kingdoms to find out how their players think, therefore to predict what that nation is going to be doing in the politics. And
but you've raised a very interesting point, because Azad, for example, the game is an important element in the story. Djarik is in the background. Azad, if you took Djarik out of Star Wars, it would make no difference at all.
Yeah.
If you took Azad out of Azad, Player of Games, there's no book.
Yeah.
If you took Quintet out of the film,
yes, it's like real world assassinations and fakes going on,
and
which are a bigger version of the
game. Azad, if you were good at the Azad game, you're obviously intelligent enough to rule it. That's how it came about. And that's actually got a real world equivalent, because Go, the Go champion in Japan, got a job in the cabinet.
Does that mean Deep Mind is now going to be in Japan?
No, Deep Mind is on the cabinet and the government, technically.
Yeah.
That's a plot.
Well, and then the Sarah Connor Chronicles, that when they're building the Proto Skynet, it's a chess computer, they're entering it in chess and Go competitions. Yeah.
You've got an artificial intelligence goes to a planet with an undeveloped society. Thing changes the society to chess so it can actually run the place. Yes?
I kind of did an equivalent of that with a card game. I mean, my characters are ready to say it, but then have all sort of really chess type thing, but cards were relatively easy to write the rules of an existing card game that I knew about, but it was quite interesting to try and have the cards almost act like a sort of tarot attack at the same time, a sort of fortune-telling game that was sort of meant to be a game, but the way the game panned out sort of threw up consequences in the story as well.
But it was a fictional game in the sense that you created a different way of doing tarot.
In effect, yes. So that people used card games, you know, just ordinary games of cards to predict the future. Whereas with tarot, you're using cards as a way of just sort of divination, sort of spread, says, all right, have you got through death or whatever, you're going to die, or that kind of thing.
Yeah.
But the game itself was to predict the way a certain thing would turn out. So the game was sort of as above, so below. So you could, the way the game played out was supposed to sort of
and there was some sort of magical way that happened.
Oh yes, definitely.
As opposed to in real life when it's all conscious.
Yeah.
That's much like Steve Erickson's game in Melisandre the Fallen.
Right.
They have their card games and could tell what would happen, and in some ways actually affected what would happen.
There's a middle ground, isn't there, between a game that's on the background. The game is essential to the actual story.
Mm-hmm.
There's something that has is maybe not essential to the story, but really adds elements to it.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're able to click a future with cards, then you have an advantage because you've looked on a few chapters ahead in the book. So you're going to win as a character.
Yeah, in a sort of way, prophecies and books, fortune telling and books. Can be, you know, they you can, as an author, you can set that up. But I was trying out a sort of new, because my magic system is a lot more sort of psychic, a lot more spiritual, a lot more sort of drawing from the weird rather than just casting a spell. That was a way of trying to sort of bring magic into the books in a kind of eerie, sort of weird way, rather than a bit like something like Tales of the Unexpected, where you've got the bizarre occurrences foreshadowed of it. I don't know. Sorry, David.
Thank you. Remind me. I did a role playing system without using dice, using cards,
One of the things I had was fortune telling, so I could actually take some cards out, put a little set of cards together, give it to the person who did fortune telling to prophesy the future. And I had this complicated system whereby if you were a ninth level person, you got 8 cards, but one was random, and that sort of stuff. And I chucked that away completely. Because the players were incapable of interpreting even the most obvious fortune telling thing. I go over water, and they went, well, let's not go over water, let's go somewhere else. What? How could you misinterpret that?
Players.
So I think if fortune telling, having done this test in the role playing game, if fortune telling actually worked, it would still be useless because no one would be able to interpret it.
You know, earlier on, you were showing the holographic one from Star Wars. There is another game that gets played as well. It's in the background, but it's crucial to various things. Is it Sabacc or whatever? Because Han Solo wins the Millennium Falcon from Lando Calrissian on a game of cards.
Yes. That's perfect.
Yeah, with the version of it.
There was another one, M. John Ford, I believe, one of the Star Trek novels, classic, and it was the first one they ever set based around the Klingon novels, and it was the game Klingzar, I think it was called, the Klingon chess, and although it's not an essential part of the story, it is quite a major part of the story. It's not a plot thing, it's in the background, and they've got various things, and I have a funny feeling there's a solo version of it, but it runs all the way from a little game of chess all the way up to the great game of politics is done in the same way. So it was one of the really, really good early Star Trek novels, and they had this chickling on chess. It was mentioned a lot and talked about, but it wasn't a plot device.
But sort it of, because it goes into politics. It's
yeah.
More like a zap, isn't it? That
yeah. Element. So you can play it as just a quick game, or you can use it as the politics.
I mean, as a writer, I'm interested in putting in games, well, I'm interested in games, so that's what I'm doing, novels, but it gives you a way of, it gives you a huge set of metaphors you can use. You invent a game that fits the world you're writing, you can then say, he does things like a knight, looks heroic, but his sword is like to the left. He's a straightforward, like a castle.
I mentioned this last night, one fictional game, Mary Gentle to Bronte's War. The brother read it a long time ago, I can't remember the name of the game, but it was used a little metaphor for the alien culture, in that it was about actual territory, in fact, changing playing pieces could change their alignment during the game. Beyond that, I can remember absolutely nothing about it.
The attack, because you stack the pieces and you drop the pieces off, when you get to the chess level, which is the stack of pieces, of course, it's made up of lots of different colours. So your chess piece can change a lot. Ladies first. That game's based on a film and stuff,
yeah.
Sort of, yes.
What if there's a game within the story? How does that fit in the full game?
So if you have
a full game of the story.
The wise man's something like that. You'd be playing the board game and then you'd have to go off and play a game of Tap. I've never heard it done. I was more interested in games that turn up in fiction and then go to the real world, rather than the other way around, which is, of course, you can get your Indiana Jones role-playing game, can't you? There are versions of Monopoly based in Star Wars and Simpsons and something else. Which is different directions. Yep.
What about reality games, as in Running Man? Even I suppose,
Hunger Games?
The Hunger Games and things like that.
The Maze.
The Maze, yes.
Survival.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I would cast those as sports.
Yeah. Deadly contact sports.
I suspect there might be a legal implication to playing the Hunger Games.
Live action role play, right? Can you run about? We did at university do a big Blade Runner killer game for a couple of weeks. So we were trying to test each other to see whether they were better. Shoot up.
If you want to really, I'm going to show engagement, from the really old game that we used to watch when I was like, Night Hatch and Pipe Pop, you had the adventure game.
Oh yes. That's a puzzle game, aren't they?
Yeah.
The king's had in the Aspidilla.
Yes, that's number four in my list of two. I must be out of time. Someone said 10 minutes confession.
No, I've been a really nice person.
Where did checkers and draughts and dominoes fit in?
Well, I would class those in the chess group. Yeah. I know they're not chess. But that element of two people opposite the board moving, because Taffel became whatever that Discord game was. Thursday, that's easy to remember, isn't it? Remembering the dwarf name where it just goes on. So they're all, I suppose, I've used chess as an example, but they're two people opposite each other on the board.
So you've got dominoes and Lyon type games.
There's a fundamental difference between things like chess and draughts, where you have all the information about your opponent. You can see everything on the chessboard. In Mahjong, you don't know what's coming out of the wall.
Same in battleships.
Same in battleships. So that's the two sorts that come from, the information complete and the bluffing information complete. If you see your opponent and your opponent, then you know the game.
Yes.
Mahjong is effectively a card game, but without cards.
Yes. But you don't know what your opponent's got.
You don't know what you're going to have.
So it's poker.
One
more question. Last question. When can we buy your fantasy series?
Oh, well, that's a very good one. First, you must play
this game.
Thank you very much.
Do talk about this and talk about it.